Unless you are a modern day Rip Van Winkle, you know that we've been experiencing a major El Nino in the tropical Pacific. As we'll see, it's one of the strongest on record, and it's having effects that are being felt worldwide, particularly in terms of patterns of weather variability, but also ecosystem impacts in the ocean as well as on land. The news has been awash in the past year with stories like this. These are some of the classic impacts: drought and out-of-control wildfires in Indonesia, deficient Indian summer monsoon rainfall, flooding in California, Texas, the Gulf states, and Florida. And it's been a record tropical storm year in the Pacific because of all the warm water, but it's also been a quiet Atlantic hurricane season. These are all classic signatures of major El Niños. El Niño in the Southern Oscillation, we all know, is a year-to-year fluctuation of the climate system that originates in the tropical Pacific. It's mediated by wind and sea surface temperature feedbacks. The warm phase we refer to as El Niño and the cold phase La Niña. We're interested in this because it's the largest year-to-year fluctuation of the climate system on the planet, and it also has tremendous socioeconomic impacts because of its effects on weather, ecosystems, and fisheries. Here's the star of our show. These are December 2015 sea surface temperature anomalies, global anomalies, and you see there in center stage are the warm anomalies associated with the El Niño between 2.5 to 3 degrees centigrade. There are other warm anomalies out there. The Indian Ocean is warm. This is typical during El Niño events. The Indian Ocean basin warms up as the El Niño matures. How well this event compares with others is illustrated here. This is one commonly used index. There are several for El Niños. This is the Niño 3.4. It's a large aerial index of deviations from normal in the Central Pacific. It's a region where the atmosphere is particularly sensitive to underlying changes in sea surface temperature, which is why it's a major focus region. It starts in 1980 and it goes to last month, December 2015. The red peaks are El Niño years, the blue troughs La Niña, as we define El Niño when the temperature rises above 0.5 degrees centigrade for 5 months or more. And so you can see the big El Niños of the last 35 years. Here's 97-98. This is by some measures the strongest in the instrumental record that goes back to the 1800s. Before that, we had a really big one in 82-83. And then right at the end of the record here is 2015-16. And you can see by eye that the anomalies we're seeing in this region are comparable to those in 1997-98. But we can highlight that a little bit more. If we chop this record up into 2.5-year segments, and we'll stack the El Niños on top of one another, and you can see how they compare in a little bit more detail. So actually, for this, I'm going back to the 50s, so we're going back 60 years ago, and there are 15 El Niños that we're stacking up in this way, plus the 2015-16. So we start July the year before the El Niño, and we end January the year after. Here's the 0.5 degree centigrade line. That's the threshold for El Niño. Black is the average of these 15 El Niños, and you can see they peak about a degree and a half or so. They begin to develop in the boreal spring, peak in November, December, January, and then roll off the following boreal spring. The purple line is 97-98, blue is 82-83, and the thick red line is the current event. And a couple things to note: this event is far above average in its amplitude. And you will note that, in fact, in the Niño 3.4 region, November and December were the warmest November and December on record. So this is it's a pretty extraordinary event. A couple other things to note about this El Niño is, you remember the El Niño that failed to happen last year, the monster El Niño that never materialized. Although it never materialized, it left a somewhat elevated temperatures on which the El Niño that failed to occur last year helped to jumpstart the big El Niño this year by just providing a higher starting point. The other thing to notice is that these 15 El Niños here, 9 of them transit into cold phase in the following year. So that's 9 out of 15. So just based on statistics, you might say that there's a 60% chance that this El Niño will revert to La Niña conditions by mid-year 2016. Now, You might say this is the strongest El Nino on record, but we want to be a little bit careful because there's spatial variability to the patterns. If we move just a little bit further to the east, here's the same presentation for the Nino 3, and you can see it's 97 winds in this comparison. So depending on which index you use, I think we can safely say it's one of the three strongest El Ninos on record.